Welcome. It's good to have you with us again, whether you're online or on TV. And we want you to know that we are in the planning stages of reopening worship, and hopefully June 28th. We'll also be having communion later in the service, so if you have bread, wine, and grape juice or grape juice, you may join us later in the service for communion. Today we celebrate Pentecost, hence I'm wearing red because that's the color of the Holy Spirit. At Pentecost is when the Holy Spirit was poured out upon the disciples, and really it's the birth of the church on that day. We begin our worship in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The Holy Spirit was not just poured out on the disciples, but also it is part of what we are promised in our baptisms. It is for all who believe in Jesus as their Lord and Savior. In Ephesians chapter 3, Paul prays for the church that they may be transformed by the Holy Spirit, that they may seek and pray for the Holy Spirit to transform them in their lives. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, as we gather in your presence, we pray that out of your glorious riches, you will strengthen us through the power of the Holy Spirit in our inner being, so that Christ may dwell in our hearts through faith. And may we, being rooted and grounded in love, be able to grasp how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ, and to know this love that surpasses knowledge, that we may be filled to the measure of all the fullness of God. Amen. May you be strong in the grace that is in Christ Jesus. Our opening hymn is Breathe on Me, Breath of God.
Breathe on me, breath of God. Fill me with life anew, that I may
the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Let us pray. Almighty God, the Father of our Lord Jesus, as you sent upon the disciples the promised gift of the Holy Spirit, open our hearts to the power of your Spirit. Kindle in us the fire of your love, and strengthen our faith and lives for service in your kingdom. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. The Holy Scriptures. Jesus ascended to heaven 40 days after the resurrection. Well, at Pentecost actually means 50 days or 7 weeks after the resurrection. If you remember, Jesus was crucified at the time of Pentecost. And he was raised during that time, and now 7 weeks later. Well, there Pentecost, or what they celebrate is the Feast of Weeks, 7 weeks after the Passover. That celebration was celebrating the 7 weeks after that is associated with the harvest, but it also associated with the giving of the Torah on Mount Sinai, the Ten Commandments. For 10 days, Jesus, after Jesus ascended, until the time of Pentecost, during those 10 days, the disciples and the other disciples, as well as Mother, the Mary of Jesus, were together praying. Our first reading is from Acts chapter 2. When the day of Pentecost came, they were all together in one place. Suddenly, a sound like the blowing of a violent wind came from heaven, filling the whole house where they were sitting. They saw what seemed to be tongues of fire that separated and came to rest on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other languages as the Spirit enabled them. Now they were staying in Jerusalem, God-fearing Jews from every nation under heaven. When they heard this sound, a crowd came together in bewilderment because each one heard their own language being spoken. Utterly amazed, they said, "Aren't all these who are speaking Galileans? Then how is it that each of us hears in their own native language?" The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Well, as I said, Pentecost is the birth of the church. When Jesus called his disciples, he said, "Come, follow me, and I will make you fishers of people." Well, that's what we see at Pentecost. They are going out. They are bringing people in to Christ's kingdom. They're no longer just disciples, but which are really student followers, but now they are fishers of people. Now they are being sent. They are apostles, sent ones. They are becoming ambassadors for Christ. As Jesus told them, "You will be my witnesses starting in Jerusalem." And here they are in Jerusalem on Pentecost proclaiming Christ. Our second reading is from Acts chapter 2. Then Peter stood up with the 11, raised his voice and answered the crowd, "Fellow Jews and all who live in Jerusalem, let me explain this to you. Listen carefully to what I say. These people are not drunk as you suppose. It's only 9 in the morning. No, this is what was promised to the prophet Joel. In the last days, God says, I will pour out my spirit on all people. Your sons and daughters will prophesy. Your men will see visions, and your old men will dream dreams. Even on my servants, both men and women, I will pour out my spirit in those days, and they will prophesy." Fellow Israelites, listen to this. Jesus of Nazareth was a man accredited by God by miracles, wonders, and signs which God did among you through him, as you yourselves know. This man was handed over to you by God's deliberate plan and foreknowledge, and you, with the help of wicked men, put him to death by nailing him to the cross. But God raised him from the dead, freeing him from the agony of death, because it was impossible for death to keep its hold on him. God has raised this Jesus to life, and we are all witnesses of it. Exalted to the right hand of God, he has received from the Father the promised Holy Spirit and has poured out what you now see and hear. Therefore, let all Israel be assured of this. God has made this Jesus, whom you crucified, both Lord and Messiah. When the people heard this, they were cut to the heart and said to Peter and the other apostles, "Brothers, what shall we do?" Peter replied, "Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. The promise is for you and your children and for all who are far off, for all whom the Lord our God will call." The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. God sent Jesus to transform the world. He was the Word of God, the Word of God in flesh. That's what we hear at the beginning of the Gospel of John. And the Word became flesh and made his dwelling amongst us. Through Christ and the Holy Spirit, God truly seeks to set men's hearts ablaze, to change the face of humanity, to help us to grow more into his likeness, because we are created in his image. Now, let us listen to our hymn of praise, Shine, Jesus, Shine.
Thank you.
Our gospel reading is from Jesus' teachings at the Last Supper. Jesus must go, but he is promising that he will send the Holy Spirit to be with them and to be in them. The gospel according to St. John, the 15th and 16th chapters. When the Advocate comes, whom I will send to you from the Father, the Spirit of truth, who goes out from the Father, he will testify about me. And you also must testify, for you have been with me from the beginning. But truly I tell you, it is for your good that I am going away. Unless I go away, the Advocate will not come to you. But if I go, I will send him to you. When he comes, he will prove the world to be in the wrong about sin and righteousness and judgment. About sin, because people do not believe in me. About righteousness, because I am going to the Father, where you can see me no longer. And about judgment, because the prince of this world now stands condemned. I have much more to say to you, more than you can now bear. But when he, the Spirit of truth, comes, he will guide you into all the truth. He will not speak on his own. He will speak only what he hears, and he will tell you what is yet to come. He will glorify me because it is from me that he will receive what he will make known to you. All that belongs to the Father is mine. That is why I said, the Spirit will receive from me what he will make known to you. The gospel of our Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Pentecost is the birth of the church. You see, Christianity is about having a living relationship with God through Christ and through the Holy Spirit. That's the key. It's having faith in the living Christ. He was not only crucified for our transgressions, for our sins, but he was raised. And now he's at the right hand of the Father. This is made possible through the inward work of the Holy Spirit, that we grow in this faith and the love of Christ within us. See, that's what he wants to do. Faith is empowered by God's Spirit. This is the reality that we see powerfully at work on Pentecost. That it's the Holy Spirit empowering the disciples to become those apostles, the ones who are going out in the very place in Jerusalem to proclaim Jesus as both Lord and Messiah, the one through whom they need to come. The power Jesus offers us in the Spirit kindles this new life, a life of faith, of hope, and love. Just as the disciples needed the Holy Spirit's power to live out Jesus' call to truly be his witnesses, we too need the Spirit's empowerment to grow in faith and to grow in love. And so too, to live out our call of discipleship and truly be his witnesses in the world. The Holy Spirit empowers us to share God's word, to show God's love, and to serve God's world. The Holy Spirit is the less visible part of the Trinity, the part of the aspect of God, if you will. Now, we understand God the Father as creator, all that exists. We look out at the beauty of the stars, the beauty of this creation, what we enjoyed this past weekend, Memorial Weekend, the beauty. All of that is a gift from our Creator, from God. But we also know God the Father is the one who called Abraham to go to a new land. He's the one who watched over him and his family. God the Father is the one who called Moses, called him to go, set my people free. He sent him to call and to bring the people out from Egypt, out of slavery. God the Father is the one who gives them the Ten Commandments, the Torah, all the teachings that they would live by, and watches over them through the course of the history of Israel. We know Jesus as the Son, born of the Virgin Mary. We know the stories. We know the stories of how he went out and he taught and he called disciples, about how he went out and he had a healing ministry. We know the story of his own crucifixion, his rejection by the religious leaders, and his rising from the dead. That's tangible. But the Holy Spirit is a little different. It's harder to grasp in some ways because it's the invisible aspect of who God is. The Holy Spirit is less visible. When Jesus was speaking to Nicodemus, he said, "Very truly, I tell you, no one can see the kingdom of God unless they are born again. Flesh gives birth to flesh, but spirit gives birth to spirit. You should not be surprised at my saying, you must be born again. The wind blows wherever it pleases. You hear its sound, but you cannot tell where it comes from or where it is going. So it is with everyone born of the Spirit." You see, born from above, born from God, the Holy Spirit making the difference in our lives, changing us. In the whole Old Testament, the Spirit or wind had the same word, ruach. And so it's the understanding of the Spirit is it's the breath of God that enlivens our lives. At the beginning of our service, we heard that hymn, "Breathe on me, breath of God, fill me with life anew." You see, that's the work of the Holy Spirit, to call us, to bring us closer to God, to love God with all our heart, to love our neighbor as ourself. The disciples had scattered when Jesus was arrested in the garden. They were gone, all except for John, when he was crucified on the cross. You see, these same disciples we see at Pentecost, in the same city, Jerusalem, only now they're shouting out who Jesus is. They're proclaiming him as Lord and Messiah, that he is the one through whom we are saved. He is the one through whom our sins are forgiven. He is the one through whom we need to come into God's kingdom. Their witness, their boldness is empowered by the Holy Spirit. Luther wrote in his small catechism concerning the work of the Holy Spirit. He said, "I believe that I cannot, by my own understanding or effort, believe in Jesus my Lord or come to him. But the Holy Spirit has called me through the gospel, enlightened me with his gifts, sanctified and keeps me in true faith. In the same way, he calls, gathers, and enlightens and sanctifies the whole Christian church and keeps it united with Christ in the one true faith." You see, it's the work of the Holy Spirit. The church is the work of the Holy Spirit. Our proclamation, our witness to who Christ is the work of the Holy Spirit through us. And through this proclamation, through this sharing of the gospel, other people come to know Christ and to believe in him, to know this Spirit that works within us. See, it's the transforming Spirit, helping us to be the people of God that we're called to be, to have and to build in us that faith and that love. I had friends who were committed Christians when I was in high school. And I knew they went to church and did different things, and they were if I guess in a way maybe unusual in the sense that they didn't swear. There was a lot of things they didn't do that others did. At times they spoke about their Christian faith, but they were never pushy. There was a genuineness about them. When I look back, I also see in myself, I look and I realize that, you know, I went to church, but I was a fan of Jesus. I knew the stories, you know, and I admired many of the teachings and knew many of them. At times I prayed, and you know what? I went to church when my mother made me. One of those friends from high school ended up going to the same college, and we were on the track team together. And he was a great witness. And I remember the things that he did. Like, he got involved in Boys and Girls Club, and he did things, he and some of the others. And they had invited me to a Bible study and stuff. I didn't go, but there was a genuineness about them. I had another friend who was also on the team, and he was pushy. And when he got pushy, it kind of pushed me away. One of the fears of becoming a committed Christian is that it might make you weird. And of course, the answer is yes. Yes, of course. Well, I Googled the word weird, and one of the definitions is suggesting something supernatural. And that's exactly what it is. Becoming a Christian, the Holy Spirit, it's supernatural. It helps us grow in our faith, in our love. It helps us truly become Christians, followers of Christ, not just fans, followers. I would never suggest that it doesn't change you, because it does. And so in Ephesians chapter 3, we heard it at the beginning of our service. In Ephesians chapter 3, Paul says, I pray that out of God's glorious riches, he will strengthen you through the power of his Holy Spirit in your inner being, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith. That's supernatural. That's the work of the Holy Spirit. He goes on and says, and may you, being rooted and grounded in love, be able to grasp how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ, and to know this love that surpasses knowledge, so that you may be filled to the measure of all the fullness of God. That is, to grow into the likeness of Christ. To grow up into that image of God, that love of God. To be gracious as God is gracious. Supernatural help. That's what it means to be a Christian follower. God working in us and through us. See, that's the work of the Holy Spirit, the comforter, the counselor that Jesus promises. In Galatians chapter 5, Paul also talks about the work of the Spirit. He says, but the fruit of the Spirit, what God produces and grows within us, is love, joy, peace, patience with others, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Against such things, there is no law. Those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. Since we live by the Spirit, let us keep in step with the Spirit. See, it's no longer I who live. I don't live by the lower nature, if you will, anger, sexual desires, and so forth. It's not that we don't have those things, but we don't want them to control us. We want to control them, to walk in God's way. One of the things that Paul says, don't let the sun go down on your anger. Don't give the devil a foothold. And that's sometimes what anger does. You see, Jesus' mission was to bring people into God's kingdom, to walk through this life as God's people, not just forgiving sins, but to free us from the sinful nature. This is the work of the Holy Spirit. And that's why Luther says that the Holy Spirit has called me through the gospel, enlightened me with his gifts, sanctified and keeps me in true faith. Sanctification is that helping us grow more and more into the likeness of Christ. To have that Holy Spirit that is producing faith, that is producing love, patience, kindness, goodness, gentleness, humility. That's the key. This is Christ's mission. And you know what? It's our mission. We're called to be people who are living in relationship with God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and calling others into that relationship with God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. How? By sharing God's word, by showing God's love, and by serving God's world. That's our mission. That's what we say our mission is. Serving God's world, just as Jesus did, and as his disciples did, as the apostles did, especially on Pentecost, as we see them going out in the streets of Jerusalem, proclaiming Jesus as both Savior, Messiah, and Lord. Jesus said, go make disciples, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey all that I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you to the end of the age. You see, that being with you is through the Holy Spirit. One of the things that Jesus says is that through the Holy Spirit, I am with you and in you. We will grow into that faith and that love. He is empowering us. I am with you. May we, along with him, along with his disciples, his apostles, take on that mission as well. May it become our mission, sharing God's word, showing God's love, and serving God's world. Now I'd like to share a song with you as we sing it together. We all are one in mission.
We all are one in mission. We all are one in call. Our varying gifts united by Christ the Lord of all. A single great commission compels us from above to plan and work together that all might know Christ's love. We all are called to service, to witness in God's name. Our ministries are different, our purpose is the same. To touch the lives of others with God's surprising grace. Well, every folk and nation may feel God's warm embrace. Now let us be united and let our song be heard. Let us be a vessel for God's redeeming word. We all are one in mission. We all are one in call. Our varied gifts united by Christ the Lord of all.
Let us affirm our faith together in the God that calls us through his Son, Jesus Christ, and enlightens our minds, empowers us for ministry, and keeps us in true faith through his Holy Spirit. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, and the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. And now let us lift up our prayers of intercession. Let us pray. Gracious Heavenly Father, we pray for your whole church on earth. Fill us with your Spirit of truth and love. Where we have sinned, purify us. Where we are in error, correct us. Where your body is divided, Lord Jesus, reunite us in your peace, we pray. May our witness to you be beacons of light for the communities in which we serve. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We lift up God's creation, the seas and the creatures that live in them, for the lands of the earth, all creatures, vegetation, and the crops of farmers. May we be good stewards of all you have placed under our care. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord Jesus, we lift up those who have gone out into the world as missionaries. Watch over them and give them courage and protection in these trying times. We also lift up to you fellow believers in countries where health services are not as prevalent as they are here. Protect the least of these brothers and sisters of Christ. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And Lord, we also lift up those for whom we carry concern in our hearts this day. We pray for their healing and comfort. We lift up to you Ruth Torreson, Danielle Rohrig, Marlene, Jay, Bernadette, Larry, Rose, Ginger, Bob, Ray, Bill, Jim, Betty, Paul, Merle, Sue, and Wayne. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord God, you are our peace and strength. We pray for our nation and the world as we face this health crisis. Protect those who are most vulnerable among us, especially all who are currently sick or in isolation. Grant patience, wisdom, clarity of mind to workers, especially those caring for others who are sick, which puts them at greater risk. Guide us as we consider how best to respond within our families, our workplaces, neighborhoods, and community. Give us courage to face these days not with fear, but with compassion, with appropriate concern and acts of service, trusting that you are watching over all of us. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Almighty God, to whom all our needs are known even before we ask, help us to ask according to your will. And for those good things which we fail to ask for, grant it for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. And now let us pray together the prayer by which our Lord taught us to pray, our Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And now we listen to our anthem, Change My Heart, O God.
Change my heart, O God. Make it ever true. Change my heart, O God. May I be like Change my heart, O God, make it ever true. Change my heart, O God, may I be like you. You are the Potter, I am the clay. Mold me and make me. This is what I pray. Change my heart, O God.
Come change my heart.
Make it ever. My heart, O God,
come change my heart.
May I be like you. You are the Potter, I am the clay. Mold me and make. Change my heart, O God, make it ever true. Change my heart, O God, may I be like you.
Let us prepare our hearts for Holy Communion. In the words of institution, Jesus promises the forgiveness of sins through his innocent suffering and death. Let us take a moment to reflect on our need for this forgiveness of sins. In 1 John chapter 1, it says, "If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness." Do you believe that you are forgiven of all your sins for Jesus' sake? If so, say, "Yes, I do. Yes, I do." You are forgiven as you have believed. And now, Lord Jesus, be present with us as you are present with your disciples and make yourself known to us in the breaking of the bread. In the night in which he is betrayed, our Lord Jesus took the bread. And after giving thanks to God, he broke it. And he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Now we participate together in the body of Christ. Again, after supper, he took the cup. And after giving thanks to God, he gave it to his disciples to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, given and shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this for the remembrance of me." We participate together in the blood of Christ. May the body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen. Let us pray. Almighty God, you provide the true bread from heaven, your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Grant that we who have received the sacrament of his body and blood may live in him and he in us, so that we may be filled with his light and life. Now send us forth to boldly live and proclaim our faith in him. Amen. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May he make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May he look upon you with his favor and give you his joy, his peace, and his love. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Go in the Spirit of Christ to love and serve the Lord, sharing God's word, showing God's love, and serving God's world. And we close with another virtual choir hymn called In Christ Alone.
In Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are stilled, when striving cease. My comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I stand. In Christ alone, who took on flesh, fullness of God in helpless babe, this gift of love and righteousness, scorned by the ones he came to save, till on that cross as Jesus died, the wrath of God was satisfied. For every sin on him was laid, here in the death of Christ I live. born with the precious blood of Christ.
For
high his and he is mine. Alleluia, alleluia.
And
I bought with the precious blood of Christ. Alleluia.
No guilt in life, no fear in death. This is the power of Christ in me. From life's first cry to final breath, Jesus commands my destiny.